I'd like to welcome you to Friends of the Island Fox's Date with a Fox for April 30th, 2024. My name is Carrie Dearborn. I'm the Education Director for Friends of the Island Fox and your host for this evening. Friends of the Island Fox is a 501c3 nonprofit organization dedicated to educating the public about the Channel Island Fox and supporting conservation and research to assure the Island Fox's survival into the future. Now tonight, we are thrilled to bring you updates from two researchers, Juliann Schamel and Dr. Alexandra DeCandia. Both of them are past recipients of research grants from Friends of the Island Fox. We hope that you feel the same pride that we do in the exciting discoveries that these young women are making, because your donations have helped to support their work. Each of our two speakers will present their talk, and after each presentation, you'll be able to ask questions for a few minutes. So please type your questions into the chat. Behind the scenes, we'll compile your questions and then present them to the speaker. Our first presentation this evening is from Dr. Alexandra DeCandia. Dr. DeCandia is an assistant teaching professor in the biology department at Georgetown University and works with the Center for Conservation Genomics at the Smithsonian's National Zoo and Conservation Biology Institute. Friends of the Island Fox first became aware of her work in 2020 when she was investigating the connection between microbes and cancer in the ear canals of Catalina Island foxes. And later that year, she expanded her microbiome, there we go, investigation to all of the island fox subspecies, and Friends of the Island Fox research grant funded the DNA identification of those microbes. She's had several papers on island foxes published in Molecular Ecology, and her work continues to expand into island spotted skunks. Now, while microbiodiversity and the microbiome may sound very complicated, I assure you, Dr. DeCandia is a fantastic teacher, and she can make the complicated easy to understand. May I introduce you to Dr. Alexandra DeCandia.
Thank you so much for the warm introduction, Carrie. I am so happy to be here with everyone at another Friends of the Island Fox Date with a Fox event. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen, and then we're going to dive into the wonderful world of microbiomes. So let's get that shared. All right. So as Carrie mentioned, we're going to kick off tonight's event thinking about some of the teeny tiny little critters that are actually inhabiting our larger scale focus for tonight, our island foxes and our island spotted skunks. I titled my talk Mysterious Microbes, How Bacteria May Help Island Foxes and Island Spotted Skunks Coexist, because that's really the focus behind all of these slides I'm about to show you. So to kick off our discussion, we are going to start with an image of a fox and a skunk as the species that we all know and love, and really the reason that we're all here tonight. But if we take a closer look at these two species, we realize that they're a lot more complicated than they initially appear. What might look like individual animals are actually entire ecosystems that contain trillions of microorganisms on every square inch. Every one of us on this Zoom call, myself included, has about 2 to 6 pounds of microbes in and on our bodies. And these microbes are not just passive hitchhikers. They're actually shaping all kinds of really important metabolic processes like development, digestion, how we respond to stress, our health and immunity, and even our behavior. And they're also shaped by their host organisms in return. So because of this relationship between hosts and their microbes, if we learn more about the bacteria that lives on an organism, it can provide all kinds of insights into the evolutionary history and the modern day ecology of microbes and their hosts, ultimately shaping how we understand how these species interact with each other in their broader environmental context. So in the case of our island fox and our island spotted skunk, they may even hold the key to answering what we consider an ecological mystery. And that mystery is the coexistence of these two species. Island foxes and island spotted skunks currently coexist on two of California's Channel Islands, They're found on Santa Rosa Island and Santa Cruz Island, which are both indicated with a star on this map. Now, that may not seem like much of a mystery or a puzzle at first glance, but it's actually really unique. When you compare islands to mainland habitats, islands tend to have fewer mammal predators, probably due to the difficulty of just colonizing that island in the first place, as well as other factors like large body size and then limited space and prey availability on the island. These limited resources and heightened competition tend to increase carnivore extinction rates, which leave little room for species to co-occur or coexist. Now, smaller-bodied predators like island foxes and island spotted skunks, which you'll see in this fabulous video, are what we call mesocarnivores because they're of a smaller size. And because of this smaller size, they might be able to overcome some of these difficulties that carnivores tend to face when trying to make their way onto an island. However, the coexistence of multiple mesocarnivores is still really rare. And that's one of the many reasons that Santa Rosa and Santa Cruz Islands are so fascinating, because island foxes and island spotted skunks have coexisted there for at least 7,000 years. And the mystery is how they've managed to do that. Now, tracking these species through time has shown that they directly compete with each other. So it's not exactly a live and let live kind of coexistence like the video may suggest. When fox populations decreased in the 1990s due to golden eagle predation, island skunk populations increased to fill the void. And when fox numbers rebounded after conservation action, our skunk populations again decreased. We can see this pattern play out in the graphs that are on the screen, where in that top figure, we see eagles increasing their population size. And then in the bottom figure, how that led to a decrease in foxes and an increase in skunks. Now, this tells us that these species are existing in tension with one another, and yet have still managed to coexist for thousands of years. So one key to this coexistence may be a phenomenon that we call niche differentiation. And all that really means is that island foxes and island spotted skunks may use subtly different resources in their environment so that they're not directly competing for every resource that's available to them. By offsetting their needs, they can coexist on the same relatively small landmass. Now we see evidence of this differentiation in their activity patterns. Now in these figures on the screen, you see skunk activity patterns in the solid line and fox activity patterns in the dashed line. And when we look at these lines, we see that skunks show a fairly dramatic swing in activity levels, where they're really active at night and not active at all during the daylight, right? This is the opposite of most people. Now, in contrast to the skunks, foxes tend to be active throughout the day and the night. They show some reduced activity in the middle of night when skunks are at their peak level of activity, but that dashed line never goes all the way down to zero. Now, we also see evidence of these kinds of divisions in their habitat use in their diet, which we're going to hear more about from Juliann's presentation in a little bit. Now, regarding their habitat, island spotted skunks tend to stay in areas with pretty significant ground cover or that are otherwise difficult to scale, like ravines. And in contrast, foxes are more than happy to move about in the open. When it comes to diet, island foxes are classified as omnivores, which means that they eat all kinds of things in their environment. Whereas an island spotted skunk, they tend to be strict carnivores that focus on prey items like Jerusalem crickets, like you see in the photo on the screen. So the overall pattern that we see across all of these different variables is that foxes tend to be generalists in their preferred activity times of day, in their habitat types, in their food choices, whereas our island spotted skunks tend to be specialists in each of these three areas. Now, together with my collaborators, including Juliann, we started to wonder if these differences would be reflected in island fox and island spotted skunk microbiomes. In essence, do we see signatures of these different preferences in the microbes that are living in their guts? As I mentioned at the start of the talk, the microbes that colonize our bodies have all sorts of important functions and might contribute to a species' ability to use certain resources. So in short, these microbes could contribute to our species' ability to coexist. So to address that question, island fox biologists with boots on the ground collected anal swabs from foxes and skunks so that we could look into their gut microbiome communities. They sent those samples all the way to Washington, D.C. for processing. where I extracted DNA from each sample, treated that DNA with a bunch of chemicals to prepare them for microbiome sequencing, generated millions and millions of DNA sequences of raw data, and then analyzed that data using a bunch of different statistical approaches implemented on my computer. So the first thing that we wanted to look at were similarities between island foxes and island spotted skunks, because they do share a pretty similar evolutionary history as they fall within this large-scale group of mammals called carnivora. Now, this group of mammals has all of those large and small-bodied carnivores that we know and love, right? Our cats, our dogs, bears, and foxes and skunks, among others. So because of this relation, we might expect them to share some of their microbes as well. And in line with these expectations, we did find that foxes and skunks do have what's called the core mammalian microbiome. So in the figure on the right of the screen, you see the main microbes that colonize island fox and island spotted skunk microbiome, or their gut communities, across both of the islands. Each of those four bars represents a population, right? So our Santa Cruz skunks or our Santa Rosa foxes. And every color in that figure represents a different type of microbe. The height of each color, it tells you how prevalent or how abundant a particular microbe is within that population. And in this figure, what's important to see is that we have the core mammalian microbiome reflected in those blues and greens, i.e. pretty much all the colors that you see, that are really just dominating that figure on the right. These main bacterial groups include things like Firmicutes, Bacteriadetes, Proteobacteria, Actinobacteria, right? All these fancy names that really just represent the microbes that are found in all mammals, including humans. Now, something that's a little more unique to these particular mammals, right, these foxes and these skunks, comes in the form of Fusobacteria, which is in that really light green color. Now, it's present across all four of our populations, but note that it's much more common in our foxes. Now, this difference is consistent with previous work that links Fusobacteria to other species of canids like wolves, coyotes, and red and gray foxes. So rather than being shared by all mammals, Fusobacteria does seem to be more so linked with mammals that are very closely related to our foxes. Now, these sorts of differences between foxes and skunks are really not surprising, because even though they're both in the carnivore group, they are found in very different parts of the family tree, which you see on the left-hand side of the screen. This is an updated phylogeny or an updated family tree for carnivora that shows our current understanding of how different groups of organisms, how different species are related within this larger scale group. The text is super tiny, it is super hard to read, but I've put little icons to indicate where island foxes and island spotted skunks sit on this tree. So we see that, yes, they are in the same order of mammals with cats and dogs and bears, and yes, they do share the mammalian core microbiome at a very broad level. But these differences may lead us to also expect that there are differences in their microbes, because they did diverge from one another quite some time ago as far as evolutionary time goes. And as mentioned earlier, we also know that they have a whole lot of ecological differences where they co-occur. So remember that our skunks tend to be more specialist in their ecology, and island foxes tend to be more generalist. So we might expect to see some signatures of this reflected in their microbiome. And that's exactly what we found. When we look at the number of different types of microbes that are present within each sample, right, within each fox or within each skunk, we see that foxes have significantly more diversity than island-spotted skunks on both islands. In this figure, our brown fox bars are always higher than our gray skunk bars. This difference may reflect the more generalist life history strategies of foxes, because foxes probably need a lot more different types of microbes in order to digest all of the different things that they're eating as omnivores. Now, in contrast, island-spotted skunks have a relatively simple diet and may require fewer microbes to break down their more meaty prey. We also see differences in the types of microbes seen in skunks and foxes. Now, in this figure, every point that you see represents an individual animal, with our gray and black dots representing skunks and our brown and tan dots representing foxes. The key to reading this figure is the proximity of the points. If two points are close together, that means that their microbiomes are really similar. And if two points are far apart from each other, that means their microbiomes are really different. So with this in mind, we found that species identity, whether you're a fox, whether you're a skunk, is the primary driver of differentiation in these microbiomes. We have all of our skunks on the left and all of our foxes on the right, and statistical support telling us that species identity explained 19% of the overall variation within our data set. But what's interesting is that we also see separation by island in our skunks along our y-axis. Santa Rosa skunks are on the top and Santa Cruz skunks are on the bottom, whereas all of our foxes seem to cluster together on the right-hand side of the figure, regardless of the island where they were sampled. Island explained about 4% of the variation in the data set and seemed to be more important for skunks based on this figure. To look further in the role of geography in shaping our microbes, we subdivided our data set into a foxes only and a skunks only data set. We've got foxes over here on the left, skunks here on the right. And here we see that both data sets are separating out by island. Without species identity polarizing the figure, the island of origin becomes really important. However, it should be noted that the significance of island differs by host species. Island only explains about 5.6% of the variation in our island fox samples, but it explained 14.6% of the variation in skunks. Now, these may seem like really small numbers, but for microbiome studies where 1,000,001 factors can shape your microbial communities, these are actually not inconsequential percentages. It makes the magnitude of difference between these results all the more striking. So when we consider them together, this result again seems to be consistent with that more generalist ecology of foxes and more specialist ecology of skunks. Foxes, through their diet and varied habitats, likely encounter and need lots of different microbial partners, leading to high diversity and less specialization. And in pretty stark contrast, skunks eating their simpler diet and living in different, fewer unique habitats may therefore have more specialization and lower microbial diversity. This can result in the two island populations of skunks diverging from each other as each becomes more specifically adapted to its local context. All of this leads us to our last big question of my presentation, which is, well, what are the actual microbes that are driving these differences that we see? We already talked about our core mammal microbes, but at this point in our study, we wanted to go finer scale and see, are there other microbes that are a little more specific contributing to our unique strategies. On the screen, the bacteria that are listed in black indicate microbes that differ between foxes and skunks. And that one line, our text in gray, indicates differences within a species, in this case within skunks. The arrows and the carrots tell you what group had a higher abundance of a particular microbe. So I'm first going to focus on the microbes that differ between foxes and skunks. Now, we can't say for certain what they're doing, but we can search the literature for any known functions or associations. And notably, we found that a lot of our microbes had hits related to potential dietary items or habitat preferences. So let's focus on foxes. Here, we found higher abundance of gamma proteobacteria compared to our skunks. This microbe has been isolated from soil invertebrates like worms and may derive from terrestrial foraging, right, or eating on land. Gamma proteobacteria is also commonly associated with canids, right? So wolves, coyotes, foxes, more broadly speaking. The second group here, delta proteobacteria, these are associated with marine environments and may come from the fact that foxes have been seen to forage along beaches. Now, in our skunks, we see higher abundance of actinobacteria on Santa Cruz and of epsilon proteobacteria on Santa Rosa Island. And both of these microbes are linked to soils and may reflect more time spent in ravines and covered spaces. So these may come from their habitat. Then that final group of bacteria mentioned, those choriobacteria, were found in higher abundance in skunks on Santa Cruz compared to skunks on Santa Rosa. This microbe is associated with crickets, and it may reflect a greater proportion of Jerusalem crickets in skunk diets on Santa Cruz. It's worth noting that there were no microbes that significantly differed in abundance between island foxes on Santa Cruz and Santa Rosa Islands. Once again, supporting this idea that island foxes tend to look more similar to one another than do island spotted skunks because they tend to be more generalized. So if we return to our original conceptual diagram with all of these results in mind, we see that our hypotheses bore out. The shared evolutionary history led to large-scale similarities in the core microbiome of each species, but different ecological strategies, and in particular, this generalist versus specialist nature of each host, led to finer scale differences. Whether these patterns are leading to that niche differentiation, whether they are resulting from existing differences, or whether they're somewhere in between, which is probably where they are, we can conclude from this that evolutionary history and contemporary ecology are both contributing to the host-associated microbiomes in these two carnivore species and are likely aiding this mysterious ability to coexist. So with that, I want to thank all of my wonderful collaborators and research partners and friend of the Island Fox for supporting this microbiome work. I always say that it takes a village to study island foxes and island spotted skunks, and I am very grateful for mine. Friends of the Island Fox and their supporters are really critical to making research like mine and Julianne's happen. And in doing so, they also support training the next generation of scientists, as a number of student researchers directly collaborated on this project with us. I'd also like to thank you for tuning in. Thank you for your time, your attention, and support. And if there's time, I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Alexandra. That was fantastic. Always fascinating. While we're getting other questions from the other people who are watching, so if you have a question, put it into the chat and so we can ask Alexandra. I did have a question I wanted to ask you, in that you were saying that the island spotted skunk are thought of as being strictly carnivorous, but the video that you showed that shows the fox and the skunk up in the tree, they're both up there looking for figs. So could it be that there are some individual skunks that are more inclined to eat an introduced fruit, which is what that is? And if so, would we see a difference in that individual skunk's microbiome potentially from skunks further in the interior of the island?
Yeah, absolutely, right? Everything that I talked about that I showed are all of these patterns that we tend to see, but there's so much individual level variation that we see in microbiomes and even in behaviors, just the way that people have different food preferences, right? Animals also have different food preferences. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, I mentioned when we can attribute, you know, 19% of variation to one variable, it sounds like so little, right? There's 81% that's something else, but it's actually quite a lot because of all of these individual preferences and behaviors and differences that we see between organisms. And so, especially with something like ecology or microbial ecology, which is what I do, it's very messy. And we're always just seeking what are the large scale patterns that we can pull out of this messy data so that we can get a generalized understanding of what might be going on in our system.
It's just so fascinating. And another question that I had is because that video showed an island fox and an island spotted skunk in a very affiliative, there's no aggression there between those two animals. But there has been some concern that foxes could potentially be preying on the spotted skunks. If indeed a fox was eating spotted skunks, would we see that potentially in its microbes coming into it from the skunk?
We probably would. This is actually something that is a little bit understudied, but that a colleague of mine is looking at in another predator-prey system where we are what we eat. And if we're eating another organism, we're not just eating that organism, we're eating that organism's microbes. And so especially, let's say a particular fox did prey upon a skunk and that happened to be the next day was when that swab was collected, we would absolutely see those signatures in our data set. of the skunk being in there. We don't know yet whether microbes are assimilated from the prey or if they just kind of pass through. That's kind of an area of future study that we need to look into. But we absolutely think that that could be the case, right? Which is like when we think about those, that one bacteria that I mentioned is associated with crickets, right? Or another one was associated with worms. Those are showing up because these animals are eating crickets because they're eating worms. And so it's this really incredible situation that we also participate in where we're constantly gaining and donating microbes to the things that we eat, the people that we touch, the doorknobs that we touch. It's this constant interchange, and there's so much variation. And there's so much variation in something that has really important implications for our health and our well-being. And so that's why it's such an active area of research and why I'm excited to see increasingly so many studies done in wildlife as well, since it all kind of started in people. But there's a lot we can learn about wildlife too. And so I'm always so grateful to Friends of the Island Fox for taking an interest in this work and being so open to me asking people to send a butt swab from a fox. And people do, and it's amazing. And then I have students who are willing to work with these butt swabs, even though the skunk ones, as you can imagine, smell horrible. Because we
all the way to getting transferred to you in Washington, D.C., they continue to smell.
Oh, they do. They do. Actually, a couple of years ago, I had some students working on the samples from this study, and we were doing it in a teaching classroom here at Georgetown. And as you can imagine, I had some colleagues who were not very happy with me because they were there after we were there in the morning. So I've been told I need to do my skunk work elsewhere, but thankfully the National Zoo is very okay with some stinky samples.
I've got another question here. Can we use the microbiome to track how the diets of each species might change due to competition as the fox population recovers?
Yeah, we absolutely can. One of the things I love about this partnership is that we have been collecting samples from different island fox populations since 2017. And on many of those islands, we're collecting every single year longitudinal samples. And so we're amassing this bank of microbiome samples in the freezer, just one building over from me here in Washington, DC, with the goal of then tracking how they change through time. Because not only might that reflect differences in their diet, but we also might be able to link it to different climate variables. Was there a dry year? Does that show something weird or different in their microbiome? Probably does, right? Versus a really wet year. So there are all sorts of these variables that we can track because there are fantastic people who are out there monitoring these foxes every year, willing to take these swabs, collect a sample, and stick them in a freezer. So there's definitely a ton of work that we can continue to do with diet. Julianne's going to talk about some of that exciting work that's ongoing in a future direction, but with these other variables as well.
And I've got one last question. Can microbes be used to help determine or verify the divergence from the mainland species, the gray fox, to the island fox, or from the western spotted skunk to the island spotted skunk?
That's an awesome question. I personally think the answer is yes, because if we see, you know, even within these different island populations, there are significant differences. I didn't talk about it today, but Carrie mentioned earlier, I have this data set of microbiome samples from all six island fox populations. And we see pretty significant differences, especially between the northern and the southern islands. And so if we were to get mainland gray fox or mainland spotted skunk samples, I don't want to say I can fully guarantee, but I can almost guarantee you they will look really different. And for me, what's particularly striking about these results is that there's currently this uncertainty, right? Are island spotted skunks their own species? Are they a subspecies? According to their microbes, they're their own thing. And even the two island populations look like their own thing as far as their guts are concerned and the microbes that live within it. So I think this is definitely evidence worth considering. It's not traditionally used when we delimit different species, but it points in that direction. It's something we can use to support other data sets that are more traditionally used, like genomic data sets and things like that.
It's just all fantastic work. Thank you so much, Alexandra, for giving your talk tonight. I wanna Double check. Juliann Schamel is out on Santa Rosa Island. So she was on and then off. We're trying to make sure that we've got her back. They've been having power outages out there on the island.
I am here.
Okay, well, then I'm going to introduce you. So from microbes, we're now going to move to whiskers and stable isotopes. Our second speaker tonight is Juliann Schamel, and she is a biological science technician working with island foxes in Channel Islands National Park. She's been studying island fox diet by analyzing stable isotopes in whiskers, and in 2018, she was the recipient of Friends of the Island Fox's first research grant. As well as working in the field on the Northern Channel Islands, she's currently a graduate student in ecology and conservation at the University of Aberdeen, Scotland. You've seen many of her images of island foxes during health checks and upon receiving new radio collars. She's had scientific papers published in PLOS One and presented both posters and papers at the California Island Symposium last fall. No one is better at explaining the important information that can come from a small bit of whisker. Please welcome Juliann Schamel.
Thank you so much, Carrie. All right, I am going to first do the screen sharing part. How's that?
Perfect.
That look good? All right. Thank you so much again, Carrie. And it is such a pleasure and an honor to be here this evening with Allie. Allie gives the best and most just wonderful presentations. I love her presentation so much. So I'm so glad to be here tonight. Tonight, I'm going to be talking about using stable isotopes to explore a decade of dietary resource use in our two endemic island carnivores on Santa Rosa Island, whom you have already met. And Allie and I like to call our research from tip to tail. So she's talked to you all about the tail, and now I will talk to you about the tip, what goes into these guys' mouths. So our story today is set on Santa Rosa Island, which is one of the two islands where island fox and skunk coexist. And our characters are the island fox and island spotted skunk, whom you have already met. And they've been coexisting on Santa Rosa Island for about 10 to 15,000 years. And I thought, who better to introduce them than themselves? So I'm going to play just a little short video here. This is an island fox on Santa Rosa Island, just outside of the Park Service housing area. And they're foraging, completely ignoring me, just foraging for some natural food. Most likely, it looks like they're most likely going after insects, I think, based on you can see them really listening intently for the little sounds in the grass. And then digging. We'll see if they're successful. Got something. All right. And then our other character is the island spotted skunk. It was a very windy day this day, but this is one of the very few times that I've seen a spotted skunk kind of just out and about. The only reason why this skunk is awake during the day is because it's just been released from one of our live traps. So I just released it, and rather than scampering away like they normally do, it stuck around and seemed to be really curious about me. So he kept looking at me through the shrubs there, which was a pretty special moment. But normally during this, if it's this much daylight, this nocturnal species would be asleep in their den during the day. So hopefully after this, he went back to bed because it's the middle of the night for him. Channel Islands National Park has a long-term monitoring program for island foxes on Santa Rosa Island. It's part of our inventory and monitoring program that keeps a pulse on the island's ecosystem health. And the program has 18 sites that we monitor every year. This marker capture data is used to estimate the fox population each year. But the fact that we have this long-term program also serves as an incredible scaffolding off of which we can build these additional research projects, like Ali's project, to learn more about fox ecology. Island spotted skunks are also captured in these fox traps incidentally, because they like the same food. So this graph shows that the total number of individual foxes and skunks that were captured at our long-term fox monitoring sites since 2009, which is when the Santa Rosa Island foxes were all released back into the wild after the captive breeding was completed. And it's really clear to see that as fox captures increased from a low of 67 to a high of about 274 captures, the skunk captures decreased, and they decreased really dramatically. Since about 2015, we've been detecting only about 9 to 35 skunks per season, as compared to the 153 skunks that we caught in 2012. And then just quickly to say, the 2009 to 11 there's no skunk data, and that is because we didn't start individually tagging skunks until 2012. So for the rest of this talk, we're going to zoom in and just focus on one site, which is Carrington Point site up on the northeast of the island. And this is the capture data just from Carrington Point. So in 2011, we caught 20 skunks and one fox. And then over time, that completely inversed. So it's very clear that the skunk captures decreased in tandem with this increase in fox captures as the fox population was recovering. But like Ali said, we don't know what exactly is driving this relationship. One possibility could be dietary competition. And if both species are coexisting on a small island and eating the same foods, the dominant competitor might get better access and more of it. And this could be particularly bad news for the subordinate competitor during times of food stress, such as the extended droughts that we've been experiencing in Southern California. So this began our inquiry. We asked a couple of research questions. First, we asked, how much do the diets of foxes and skunks overlap? And does that overlap change at different densities of each species? And then we asked, what are foxes and skunks eating? And how flexible are their diets? Dietary flexibility can be extremely beneficial to helping a species survive in a changing environment, and particularly on a small island where they can't leave or migrate to better pastures. For our methods, we chose to sample from three time periods to assess how the density of each population influenced diet. So we sampled from the early years when there were lots of skunks and hardly any foxes, the middle years when they were about equal, and then the present when we've got a lot of foxes and not very many skunks. And the sample that we took was whiskers. Look at those beautiful whiskers on that spotted skunk. Whiskers are ideal for studying diet in wild critters for two special reasons. One, they are continuously growing, and as they grow, they are essentially a new tissue that is built from the animal's metabolism, from the atoms that ultimately came from what it ate. And another important aspect of whiskers is that they are inert. So once they grow, they don't change and they stay as they were built. And this makes them kind of like layers in a tree. So one whisker records about 6 months of dietary data for that individual animal. To ask a whisker about diet, you have to enter the invisible world of stable isotopes. And we measure carbon and nitrogen using this complicated looking calculation, which is essentially just a measure of relative abundance. So we measure the ratio of carbon-13 to carbon-12, and nitrogen 15 to nitrogen 14. We're going to take a super quick dive back into high school chemistry, so hold on tight, but this will go by fast and hopefully will be a bit fun. So carbon atoms are made up of 6 protons and 6 electrons. And if they also have 6 neutrons, they're called carbon 12. The 12 comes from the total number of things that are in the nucleus of it, the 6 protons and 6 neutrons. And this makes up about 99% of the carbon on the planet. If the carbon atom has 7 neutrons, then it's called carbon 13. And this makes up about 1% of the carbon on the planet. And because of that one extra neutron, it's just a little bit heavier than the carbon 12. And that's going to become important later in the story. And nitrogen is the exact same thing, it's just different numbers. So a nitrogen has 7 protons and 7 electrons. And if it has 7 neutrons in its nucleus, it's called nitrogen 14, which is about 99% of the nitrogen in the world. And if it has 8 neutrons, it's called nitrogen 15, which is about 1% of nitrogen in the world. And again, that nitrogen 15 is just the tiniest bit heavier. One atom is just a tiny bit heavier than one atom of nitrogen 14. So what we measure when we do stable isotope analysis is the ratio of carbon 13 atoms to carbon 12 atoms in a sample. And this can be used to infer information about the photosynthetic pathway or the base of the food web that that animal was eating at, which I'll show in a bit. And then nitrogen is measured as the ratio of nitrogen 15 to nitrogen 14. And this can be used to infer information about the trophic level at which that animal is eating. And we'll now take a look at how stable isotope data is visualized and how you can interpret the graphs of data. So the x-axis displays the carbon data, and most terrestrial plants, the photosynthetic pathway that terrestrial plants take means that they will be plotted on the left side of the graph, while marine photosynthesizers like phytoplankton will plot on the right side of the graph. The x-axis displays the nitrogen data, and generally, the higher the nitrogen value represents eating higher up the food chain or at a higher trophic level. So this is an example of isotopic data from 2 species, and you can see that species A in blue is eating mostly terrestrial food items, whereas species B in orange is eating probably a combination of terrestrial food items and marine-derived food items. Another thing that you can do with stable isotope data is look at how much 2 different species' diets overlap with each other. So here we can see these circles that represent the core diet area for the 2 species, with species A in blue and species B in orange. And then you can calculate the overlap of how much of their core diet overlaps with the other species. So we went out and collected a bunch of whiskers from foxes and skunks. And then we took those samples to New Mexico, to the Center for Stable Isotopes at the University of New Mexico, where we worked with Dr. Seth Newsom. And I'm going to show a little bit about the process for processing the samples. So a single whisker from an individual can tell us about what that animal is eating for the past 6 months. And you cut them up into these tiny little segments. This is the base of the whisker. So that's the most recently grown piece of tissue. And that will tell you what that individual has eaten most recently. And then over at the other side, at the tip of the whisker, that contains information about what the animal was eating about 6 months ago. The smallest amount of tissue that you can analyze is 0.25 milligrams. So this is just a little video that shows putting, this is actually a hair sample, not a whisker sample, but putting a tiny little sample into this tin capsule, and then you weigh it on a really expensive scale. And the hair samples were being weighed out to 0.5 milligrams. Once you've weighed out your sample, you crush up the little tin capsule so that all of your sample is contained inside of it. And then you put those into these trays. So here's 100 samples all prepared to go into the mass spectrometer. And this is an example of what the data looks when it comes out the other side. So this is data from, these are individual segments from a single whisker. And you can see that over time, from the base to the tip, that the diet was changing. The base represents the diet at the date of collection, and then the tip is about 6 months ago. So what did we find out after all of this? This graph will look familiar to you from before, and it is in fact our data from this project. So the blue is the skunk data, and the orange is the fox data from our Carrington Point site. And these are the results from the early years. So in 2011, when there were a lot of skunks and not very many foxes. And what's really interesting is the skunks are down in the terrestrial corner of the plot. And the foxes are kind of spanning from terrestrial over to marine, but they aren't, the two species are not overlapping with each other yet. Then we go to 2014. And you see there is a little bit of overlap starting. And by 2018, when the landscape is covered in foxes and there's only a few skunks, you can see that the fox diet as a whole population of foxes has expanded, and it has essentially completely encompassed the diet of the skunks. The skunk diet stays pretty similar throughout the whole time. It stays about the same size on the plot and in approximately the same place. So in a terrestrial spot on the plot. Another interesting thing that we found in the data is that individual foxes plotted in very different places. So there seems to be a lot of individual diet specialization in foxes on Santa Rosa Island, where some may be specializing in marine diets, and some may be specializing in terrestrial diets, even eating more fruit or more insects. What did we learn so far? So our first question was, how much do the diet of foxes and skunks overlap? And does the overlap change at different densities for each species? And we learned that the diet of the two species overlaps more as fox density increases. So it seems that the fox diet will expand as there are more foxes on the landscape, probably because they are very flexible in what they're able to eat. So if there are more foxes out there looking for food, they can kind of, as individuals, they can go after different food items from the other foxes that are on the landscape, whereas the skunk diet seemed to stay the same across the whole study time period. And then I didn't actually show data from this in this talk, but we also did this same study at a site in the interior of the island, and we found that the diet overlaps more in the interior than it does on the coast, which makes sense. If foxes on the coast are able to access marine foods and skunks are not eating those marine foods, but the foxes that live in the interior of the island won't have access to any marine food. So the fox and skunk diet actually overlapped more at that site. And we also asked, what are foxes and skunks eating and how flexible are their diets? And we found that skunks seem to have an exclusively terrestrial diet and that the fox diet is more flexible and includes some marine foods. I think we briefly touched on this in Ali's talk, but if you're talking about diet, then you definitely are going to be interested in what these animals are eating. And this is the, kind of the next step in this study. So we've got the island deer mouse, and we have a few species of lizards on the island. Jerusalem crickets there in the bottom left are a big favorite. And then we have a beach hopper in the middle and some toyon berries in the bottom right. So for the mice, both foxes and skunks love to eat deer mice. And both foxes and skunks have been found to eat lizards. This is through scat studies that have been done in the past. Both foxes and skunks also love to eat Jerusalem crickets and other insects, but only foxes have been found to eat beach hoppers on the beach, and only foxes have been found to eat a lot of fruit in the diet, particularly toyon on Santa Rosa Island. And then I'm just going to show a little sneak peek of an upcoming collaboration that we've got with Allie and another island fox biologist, Katie Elder, who is also a past recipient of a Friends of the Island Fox research grant and is a master's student at Cal Poly SLO and currently a fox biologist on Catalina. And I believe that she's presented her work in the past at a Friends of the Island Fox meeting. So we are hoping to combine with individual foxes, GPS collars, so that we can get home range and habitat use information from individual foxes. That would be combined with accelerometer data to look at individual activity patterns, stable isotope data to look at individual diet, and microbiome data to look at individual microbiomes. And we're hoping to combine all of these data streams together to get what I think will be an unprecedented window into the lives of individual wild island foxes from tip to tail. That is coming up in the next year. We're hoping to start that study. And just before I finish, I wanted to mention an awesome website that is maintained by the Nature Conservancy's biologist, Laura Brinner, islandspottedskunk.com. If you want to learn more about island spotted skunks, this website has, I think, everything about island spotted skunks that you could ever want to know. It's a great website. And I also wanted to mention the skunk pins that Carrie and Allie are wearing. These were designed by my colleague, Stacy Baker at Channel Islands National Park. And in collaboration with Friends of the Island Fox, they are currently for sale at the Channel Islands National Park Visitor Center. And you can also purchase them on the Friends of the Island Fox website as well. And all of the proceeds from these pens are currently funding island spotted skunk research. With that, I will say thank you very much to everybody for having me here and for coming tonight. And I will pass it back over to Carrie.
We do have a couple questions for you, Juliann, so don't run away. I'm gonna put my video on, I guess. One of the questions was, what do you think what's your view of the skunk's future on the islands? With what do we really know about that declining number of skunks, island spotted skunks?
I will say that I have a pretty positive outlook on the future of this island spotted skunks. hopefully it's not too positive, but especially on Santa Rosa Island, we're finding that although our detection of skunks has declined as the foxes recovered, we are still detecting them every year. And the most kind of hopeful thing to me is that we are detecting them everywhere on the island. So they seem to still be persisting across the island in all habitats, but maybe just at a lower number, and they may be also just changing their behavior to be a bit more cryptic. If folks are interested in learning more about that, the Island Spotted Skunk Working Group meeting next week, there will be a master's student presenting on that question.
And I have a specific question for you about whiskers. How old can a whisker be to be tested?
A whisker can be, I'm going to throw out a ridiculous number. I don't know. Let's see. I have not yet met a whisker that was too old to be tested.
All right.
The great thing about whisker samples is that because they are an inert hair sample, they don't break down, and they keep the data is there. And so you can you can find some old whisker samples that somebody collected 20 years ago and they put in a drawer and forgot about. And if you find those, you can analyze them and get information from them.
That's amazing. So the vital thing then would be to know when it had been collected.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And do the whiskers of the island foxes and the island spotted skunks grow at a similar rate?
That's a great question. We have done some studies with captive island foxes to learn the growth rate for island foxes. So that's where we got the 6 month the 6 months information. Mm-hmm. That has not been done for skunks. So we don't actually know how long it takes a skunk to grow its whisker out.
So we're still looking for a spotted skunk in somebody's zoo facility or something where some of this captive information could be found out about spotted skunks.
Yeah, that would be great.
So in your graphs that you were showing with the overlap in the diet and how it was changing between the island fox and the island spotted skunk, did it appear that as there became more foxes in the environment, that they were supplanting the island spotted skunk in that lower terrestrial area of the food resources? Or was it just, can you really tell that?
I don't know if you can really tell. I guess the pieces, kind of the two pieces of information that we have both support that may be the case, because we detected fewer skunks. So we don't, just because we detected fewer doesn't mean that there are fewer, because there could be reasons why you detect fewer. Mm-hmm. But we did detect fewer skunks. And then with the fox diet expanding to kind of encompass the same diet that skunks were eating, you may infer that they're then directly competing for those resources. So maybe there's just not as much of the food that skunks need to eat in that area.
And so do you really think that there's a greater food competition in the interior of the island between foxes and skunks?
Yeah, I think there is. Yeah.
That's what it kind of seemed like. Well, we've had some really great questions, and people are saying amazing presentation, so informative, both of them, and engaging. Thank you to both of you. Just really fantastic to hear you both. And this work that the two of them are going to go on and do as a joint project that's looking at that cross-section of microbes and diet, focusing on these 15 individual foxes and how the individual fox foraging behavior cascades through the ecosystem. Like Juliann was saying, this is a cutting-edge investigation. It's looking at how individual island foxes may impact the island ecology differently. And that's not typically what people think of. So this Friends of the Island Fox did award a research grant to the two of them in 2023 that's going to be helping to process some of their samples for this new research they're doing. So stay tuned. There's going to be more about this specific information from their investigation that's going to go on in the future. Thank you to both of you so much. If there was something that anyone missed tonight or you'd like to hear again, a video recording of tonight's presentation will be available on the Friends of the Island Fox website. That's islandfox.org. Sometime in the next few weeks, you can also find past programs posted on the website under the video audio tab. Friends of the Island Fox is planning a trip to Santa Cruz Island in September. If you would like to join us, information will be emailed to donors first and then to our e-newsletter. You can sign up for our free e-newsletter on islandfox.org. We send out a newsletter about every other month. A huge thank you to Dr. Ali DeCandia and Juliann Schamel, to Michael Lachey behind the scenes, and all of you joining us tonight. Friends of the Island Fox has become the number one supporter of Island Fox specific research, and donors like you make that possible. I'm Carrie Dearborn. Date with a Fox will be back in August or September, And we hope that you can join us then. Good night, everyone. Thank you so much.